Hey, it's Fran again, and I wanted to do a very special video about one of my personal obsessions, and that is the mighty Saturn V moon rocket, and in particular, the gargantuan F1 engines, which were made by Rocketdyne Propulsion. And five of these incredibly powerful engines, the most powerful engines ever built, powered Saturn V moon rocket, and I wanted to do this video explaining how the F1 engine worked. I'm not going to get into all the details, but I'm going to give you a really good idea of how the engine worked and functioned. And let's start by talking about the propellants. The F1 engine was powered by a combination of liquid oxygen, sometimes called LOX, and a highly refined form of kerosene called RP1. The F1 engine uses a combination of these propellants in a ratio of about 2.25 liquid oxygen to every 1 unit of RP1 in the thrust chamber. And the basic components of the F1 engine are a large unit that is known as the turbopump assembly, which combines a liquid oxygen pump, a pump for the RP1 fuel, a turbine that turns the whole turbopump, and a heat exchanger, and the gas generator. These are the major components. I want to talk about the gas generator first because it is a rocket motor inside of the rocket motor. It is essentially an internal combustion engine that drives the whole F1 engine. It does this under the same pressure as the rest of the F1 engine. It is a reciprocal regenerative system. There are very few moving parts in the F1. This is done by design. Almost all of the actions that occur in the entire system are done by the dynamics of fluids, hydraulic pressure, the pressure of the propellants, and gases. And the actual number of moving parts, including valves and such, are kept to an absolute minimum. The gas generator is a small chamber that's nestled inside of the assembly. And inside of the gas generator, liquid oxygen and RP1 are burned to create high-pressure gases, which are used to turn a turbine, which then turns the turbopump. But the issue is that the gas generator, even though it's burning the same liquid oxygen and RP1, it has to be self-contained and it can't melt and overheat. And rather than putting the gas generator inside of some kind of coolant jacket like the thrust chamber is, for example, what they decided to do was to burn the liquid oxygen and the RP1 in an extremely fuel-rich combination. And because of this extremely fuel-rich mixture in the gas generator, the subsequent gases that are produced and expelled out of the gas generator to turn the turbine are really sooty and burn at a much cooler temperature, around 800 degrees or so, which keeps the gas generator from melting, but creates an incredible amount of hot gas, which is pushed into the turbine. That turbine turns this huge shaft, which is directly hooked up to the turbopumps for the liquid oxygen and the fuel. Upon leaving the turbine, this hot gas immediately goes into this large chamber called a heat exchanger. And inside the heat exchanger are tubes that are coiled up that the liquid oxygen and helium go through. The helium is used as a pressurant for all the propellant tanks because helium is an inert gas, it's non-reactive. And it's also used to prevent a type of oscillation that was occurring in the early constructions of the Saturn V, so some of that helium is pumped into the oxygen pipes that are supplying liquid oxygen to the F1 engines, and this pressurized helium is pushed into the ducts supplying liquid oxygen, creating this bubbling of helium inside of the pipes to allow the liquid oxygen to be not so highly compressed, because there were pogoing effects that were causing the early Saturn V's to jostle around to the point where it would cause injury to astronauts. And to prevent this pogoing, they had to push this helium into the pipes that were coming down through the fuel tank with liquid oxygen to make the liquid oxygen less dense in the pipes so that it could kind of compress. Because as a liquid, the liquid oxygen really can't compress at all. And allowing these helium bubbles to form in the tubes that were supplying the liquid oxygen allowed it to be kind of cushy and springy on the way down to the engines, and it prevents this pogoing effect. And also heating up the liquid oxygen, putting it back into the liquid oxygen tank as a pressurant, again, to allow more upper pressure of the liquid oxygen feeding into the F1 engines. This was a very important point because the amount of propellant coming into the F1 engines is absolutely astonishing. Every second, 2.5 metric tons of propellant, it's liquid oxygen and RP1, were going into each F1 engine. Every second. And going back to the heat exchanger, after the exhaust gas from the gas generator has gone through the heat exchanger, it goes through this large manifold, which is kind of a signature. You see it at the bottom of the thrust chamber. And it is this turbine exhaust manifold which is distributing the leftover gas, which is still hot, coming out of the heat exchanger, and it's pushing that gas down to the nozzle extension. Because it's not really widely known that the F1 engine ends at the turbine exhaust manifold. The cone that you see, probably like half of the F1 engine that's visible, is actually an extension that was put onto the F1 engine to increase its efficiency at higher altitudes. Because the Saturn V first stage, also known as the S1C, it gets out of the lower atmosphere very quickly, and as it gets into the rarefied atmosphere, efficiency of the rocket engines becomes a big importance. And so the extension was put on to make the engine more efficient at these higher altitudes. But to keep that extension cool, that is, to keep it from actually melting, this hot exhaust gas is pumped into the extension. And in this photograph that I took of an F1 engine at the Smithsonian Air and Space Museum, you can clearly see these interlocking sort of shingle-like steel plates which are laid out on the interior of the nozzle extension. And if you see very closely, these plates have a slightly rippled kind of contour to them. And that's by design, because those hot, sooty exhaust gases from the gas generator are being forced through these tiles on the inside, and this keeps those tiles cool enough not to melt, and this sooty exhaust gas from the gas generator coming through those apertures in the nozzle extension and between those tiles, it creates the signature look of the dark flame that's seen coming directly out of the nozzle extension. That sort of dark column that eventually turns to a white blaring blaze, it's that dark flame, which is the unburnt fuel in that mixture of the gases that are coming right out of the gas generator that are being rapidly consumed by the inner fury right behind that wall. And that's what gives the Saturn V its definitive dark flame coming out of the nozzle. The turbopumps are a wonder of engineering, and both the liquid oxygen and the RP1 pumps are built into two different sections. One is sort of a corkscrew type pump, which the fuel and liquid oxygen enter in first, which pressurizes the propellant to a certain point, and then it feeds into a more of a centripetal pump, which then expels the propellant at a extremely high pressure into an outer manifold. And the reason that they did these pumps in two distinct sections was to reduce cavitation, which would have been a tremendous issue at these very high pressures. If the propellants were to change pressure too quickly within the pump, the cavitations caused by that would feasibly tear the turbopumps apart and disintegrate the blades of the turbopumps. So this multi-sectional design was done to basically keep the pumps from exploding and disintegrating, and the output of the turbo pumps go directly into the thrust chamber through a very amazingly designed component called the injector plate. The injector plate is made out of a copper alloy, and copper was used because of the great heat conductivity of copper, that it would be less likely to get hot spots than any other material. It's really the thermal conductivity. The whole injector plate is made up of 2,800 or so copper pipes that lead the liquid oxygen and the RP1 to thousands of injectors that push this 2.5 metric tons propellant through the injector every second. Interspersed among all of these tiny little tubules for the propellant are these very specialized little nozzles, which are for the hypergol chemicals. There was a need to ensure start of the F1, and so hypergolic chemicals were injected into the thrust chamber at startup, and there's a very complex sort of dance that occurs to get the F1 started. It's not an easy process. But again, to eliminate sort of the mechanical parts, these burst capsules were used, where a hypergolic chemical, which would react with liquid oxygen to create combustion, were put into these burst capsules, which were placed inside of the fuel feed lines, so that when the turbopumps got up to a certain area of pressure, when they were winding up to get up to full thrust, as the pressure in the fuel lines got to a certain point, it would burst these capsules of hypergol fluid, and that hypergol would be mixed with the fuel to enter into the injector plate to mix with the liquid oxygen that was already present in the thrust chamber. And there was an issue with the F1 starting up too fast, because if the F1 were to just immediately start at full thrust, the shock of that could very feasibly wrench the engine away from the stage or cause structural failure in the Saturn S1C stage. So to prevent that from happening, there had to be a slower startup to all of these pressures. And one of the things that they did to ensure that was to pre-fill the thrust chamber with ethylene glycol. The thrust chamber is not solid. It's actually a bell-shaped construction that's made up of hundreds of hollow tubes. And these tubes are made of a special nickel alloy, which was chosen because it has very good stability, even at high temperatures. And the thrust chamber was made up of these tubes that were brazed together, because the brazing process requires a lot of heat, and you can't have any kind of like imperfections in it. It really had to be done in an oxygen-free environment, and so they actually created a blast furnace, special furnace, where the entire completed thrust chamber assembly was brazed all at once in a controlled environment at extremely high temperatures. Just an amazing, amazing thing to even think about today. It's one of the reasons, you know, between the injector plate and the thrust chamber, that really can't just go and make Saturn V's with F1 engines anymore, because the specialized tooling that was needed just to create these engines was just incredible. But this sort of hollow network of tubes, which created the thrust chamber, fuel was pushed into the thrust chamber to keep it cool enough not to melt, and the fuel going through the thrust chamber would be preheated before it went into the turbopumps to actually go into the combustion chamber. But to keep the F1 engine from starting up too fast, the inside of the thrust chamber was filled on the launch pad with ethylene glycol, so that when the turbopumps started up, the fuel mixture that got into the thrust chamber first was very rich in ethylene glycol, and this retarded the combustion a great deal, so that rather than having an explosive bang when it first started up, it was more of a whoosh, and this eased the structural tension on the whole rocket. And without being able to do this, if the F1 engines, all five of them, had just sort of turned on at the same time, full thrust, it could have just wrecked the whole first stage. But in addition to the fact that they wanted the F1 to start up a little slower, there was also a very ingenious way of holding the Saturn V rocket back from just taking off from the launch platform too fast, because again, they didn't want the astronauts to get injured. The G-forces could have been incredible if they just would have let the rocket go. Once all five of the F1 engines in the Saturn V first stage came up to full thrust, a command was given to the launch platform to let go of these hold down arms, which are actually holding the rocket down to the launch platform. But when those arms came away, the rocket would have taken off too fast. So to hold it back just a little bit longer, those hold down arms at the assembly, they had these special bolts that were going into these tapered dies, which were mounted onto the rocket S1C first stage frame, and these bolts were actually in the launch platform. And the intersection of these two had a tapered fit, a pressure fit, and the force of those F1 engines pulling the Saturn V rocket up off the platform, it very slowly pulled these steel bolts through these tapered dies, and it just held back the force of the rocket until finally those bolts pulled out of the dies and the rocket was free to take off. It's just amazing everything that they went through to ensure a smooth takeoff of the Saturn V, even trying to rein in the incredible forces that were being created with each one of the Saturn V engines at sea level, creating somewhere up to 6.8 million newtons of force per engine. After the Saturn V got out of the lower atmosphere and got into the more rarefied atmosphere, the efficiency of the F1 engine increased about 20% towards the end of its flight. The Saturn V first stage only really burned for about 2.5 minutes, but in that time, it managed to get the entire Saturn V moon rocket over 60 kilometers in altitude and almost 100 kilometers downrange. And the interesting thing is, shutting off the stage, they really couldn't just turn the engines off. There was a very elaborate shutdown period, and the shutdown of the engines had to be coordinated to make sure that stage separation could occur properly, and they didn't want the tanks to like run dry through the engines, because all these sort of uncertain things could have happened if the engines were to get too rich with fuel, or if they were to get too much liquid oxygen in the mixture, that the engines start firing differently, or if the engines were to go off in different certain orders, that it could cause the whole rocket to twist around and go off course. So there was a very elaborate and controlled shutdown of all the F1s, and they were all shut off completely before stage separation. And in order to sort of facilitate the stage separation, when you see it shot from a telescope on the ground, you see this huge plume of gases at stage sep, and that's retro rockets, because on those little sort of cowlings that go around the outer F1 engines, those four sort of rounded cowlings that have the fins attached to them, on the upper parts of those, there are little plates that were blow free, and there are these retro rockets mounted in all four corners, which fired off at stage separation, and those were to pull the massive S1C stage away from the remaining Saturn rocket's second stage. And that's the huge plume you see, are those retro rockets firing, trying to get the S1C stage away from the second stage as quickly as possible. Well, I've left out an awful lot. There's a lot of details, little details, if you want to learn about how the F1s worked and started up. There's an amazing procedure for the startup, getting them running and everything, and lots of details in what the metallurgy and the way they were constructed and welded and such. Just amazing, the complexity. And also, if you read about the F1s, there was so much that went into designing the injector plate. It was probably like the single most challenging part of the design, because early F1 engines, they were just exploding on the stand, and it came down to the idea that there were instabilities and oscillations that would occur in trying to combust so much fuel and oxygen that there were instabilities that would happen and the oscillations would begin and that would just start to break the whole thrust chamber apart. And so they ended up putting these baffles into the injector plate, which are shown as sort of these sections, you know, these raised up sections. And these baffles were put in there to stabilize the fuel oxygen mixture going into the thrust chamber. And it was one of the most triumphant engineering achievements of the Saturn program, was coming up with this injector plate, you know. But anyway, I hope you found this interesting. Like I said, I simplified some things. I didn't want this to be too long, but I encourage you to read up on the F1 and Rocketdyne and the Saturn V propulsion systems. There is so much to learn, and it's still fascinating what they were able to do. And we're still learning today from the F1 engine, and hope that you enjoyed this video. I'll be back again with something over at the bench real soon. Thanks a lot.
That's where I work. Berserk in my lab. It's where I work. At the bench.